Audible, Inc. presents Investing Without Wall Street, The Five Essentials of Financial Freedom. Written by Sheldon Jacobs. Narrated by Kevin Young. Preface. With some books, the preface is unimportant. That's not the case with this book. The preface provides an overview of what investors really need to know to prosper in today's markets, which are so very different from the ones we loved in the 1980s and 1990s. But first, I need to quickly touch on two money-making basics. 1. Do-it-yourself is the real key to lifetime profits. First of all, you need to appreciate the huge difference between doing it yourself and hiring professional guidance. Although there is value in a book explaining the best ways to work with a broker or professional investment advisor, the real benefit comes from a book that teaches you, simply and clearly, how to do it yourself. The wealth difference is overwhelming. Over a 40-year investing lifetime, an average earner can make $252,000 more doing it him or herself than a person who has to share his or her profits with professionals. That's a lot of money going to advisors, not you. That's why this book is titled Investing Without Wall Street. The computations are in Chapter 4. Achieving this wealth increment is within everybody's ability and takes very little time. In addition, by doing it yourself, you will know your self-interest has always been put first. That's no small thing in an era where crooks like Bernard Madoff stalk uninformed investors. Investing Without Wall Street gives you control of your finances. 2. Savings are crucial. All the advice offered in this book is academic if you have no money to invest. Money is accumulated by saving. Savings are not just a good idea, they are crucial. There is no need for this book to discuss the mechanics of saving. You simply spend less than you earn. If you don't already have savings, start saving. Start as early as you can. The earlier, the better. If you have some savings, save more. A 12-year-old's commentary on saving. The top reasons why I think it is important to save are 1. To help me tell the difference between my needs and wants. 2. To gain interest on my money. 3. To save for larger things, such as a bicycle. 4. Currently, I am working to raise money to go to camp next summer. Sarah, Shepherdstown, West Virginia. Reported by Michelle Singletary, WashingtonPost.com. As Bill Donahue, the money market maven, once said, if you can't live on your income now, you can't live on 10% less. So save 10%. Here's a summary of the book's investing advice and philosophy. Today's times call for more conservative strategies. In the 1980s and 1990s, the buy-and-hold investing strategy superseded all others. You didn't have to be a brilliant stock or fund picker. All you had to do was buy and hold stocks, and you could have earned 18 to 19% a year. The market is unlikely to achieve gains of this magnitude again in my lifetime, and possibly yours. That's because secular bull markets, the long-lived megatrends that last 5 to 20 years, usually occur only when there are dynamic, new, giant growth industries, such as computers, information technology, the internet, and in earlier eras, canals, railroads, electricity, and automobiles. They provide the basic foundation. All of these advances had myriad applications over a broad range of industries. I don't see anything comparable on the horizon. Technological advances since the computer and the internet became mainstream have been more evolutionary than revolutionary. The new social media are evolutionary, even though they have produced several billionaires. For many years to come, I believe stock markets will be in a secular bear market. They will move up and down, not basically up as in the 1990s. I expect average gains over the next decade or more will be in the neighborhood of 6 to 7% annually. That's because I don't see any reason for the price-to-earnings, or P.E. ratios, of stocks to expand significantly in the coming years, and they may possibly contract. In the 1980s and 1990s, 43% of all gains came from P.E. expansion, as investors paid more and more for a dollar of corporate earnings. I believe stocks over the next decade or more will at best gain pretty much in line with their earnings increases, which will depend to a greater extent on the economy than has previously been the case. The good news is that this means stocks can still deliver returns superior to bonds or cash, albeit with greater risk, which I'll show you how to control. The best news is that since stocks declined 38.5% in 2008, they could easily have double-digit gains over the next 5 to 6 years and return to that estimated long-term average. A study by Capital Guardian Funds found that when the S&P 500 index had an annual return of 2% or less over a decade, stocks gained between 10% and 17% annually in the ensuing decade. The annualized return for the 10 years ending in 2008 was negative 0.93, and the S&P 500 gained 23.5% in 2009 and 12.8% in 2010. Regardless of the volatility, equities must continue to have a place in your financial planning, particularly if you are young. Sheldon Jacobs' Statement of Purpose. Investing books are commonly written to enhance authors' careers. However, that was not my motivation. I've had two successful careers, each a quarter century long, and I have no desire for a third go-to-the-office job. I didn't write this book to sell newsletters or obtain managed account clients. I sold both my money management business and newsletter a few years ago, but I continued to work as a contributing editor of the Investor newsletter. In addition, I am on the finance committee of the Westchester Community College Foundation in New York, where I help to manage a multi-million-dollar institutional portfolio. And lastly, I manage my personal investment portfolio. The purpose of this book is to share with others the important lessons I have learned over a lifetime. I have always written about what interests me, and right now, what interests me is making my investing as simple as possible. Investing without Wall Street is a guided tour based on personal experiences. Most of the strategies that I offer in this book, I have tried myself. I know they work. I am not a genius. I have always looked for ways to make money without being a Goldman Sachs-level expert, and I promise you that any ordinary person will be able to implement the profit-making recommendations in this book. There are two reasons for this. First of all, investing literature commonly attempts to tailor advice by investor demographics, age, wealth, time horizon, and risk preferences. Investing without Wall Street does this too, but in addition, it offers advice by degree of desired investor involvement. It speaks to investors who are willing to spend time to obtain the best results, but mostly to the more numerous investors who are simply seeking a comfortable nest egg while getting on with their daily lives. Secondly, the specific advice offered takes into account what I think investors will actually do on their own, since no matter how wise the advice, it's not productive if investors don't follow it. Finally, you'll quickly see that I don't always agree with the conventional wisdom. And as you discover how much about investing there is to learn, you may find you have even more to unlearn. In November 2010, the Bottom Line personal publication observed, among financial experts who were able to think with a small investor's perspective, no one is more level-headed than Sheldon Jacobs. My approach to financial profits. Between 1974 and 2004, I wrote 24 books, as well as the No-Load Fund Investor, a top-ranked monthly mutual fund newsletter that I founded to provide specific investing advice, recommendations, and model portfolios. The books and newsletter basically offered advice within the framework of a secular bull market. Because investor interest was concentrated almost exclusively on profit-seeking in those bull market years, like virtually every investing publication in those decades, I placed greater emphasis on profits than on risks. even though my recommendations in those years were conservative compared to most of my colleagues, long-term bearishness would not have served my readers. But times have changed, and so has my advice. In Investing Without Wall Street, I have expanded on the tried-and-true wealth creation programs to take into account the challenges of the new market climate. Investing Without Wall Street emphasizes both risk control and profits by zeroing in on five essentials. The five essentials. This book is divided into three parts. Part 1, chapters 1 to 5, discusses five principles that are the essence of the knowledge you need to be a successful equity investor. Master these five essentials, and you'll have the wherewithal to be a successful investor without the need of professional assistance. They are your priorities. 1. Determine the right asset allocation. 2. Properly diversify within asset classes. 3. Understand and control risk. 4. Keep your costs low. 5. Choose the right financial media to follow. I suspect that at this point some of you are thinking, I've heard most of these principles for ages. And probably you have, but I will bet that a good number of you have never really understood their importance or how best to apply them. You will also notice that security selection, choosing specific stocks or funds, most advisors' favorite recommendations, is not one of the five essentials. Notwithstanding its ubiquitous coverage by the media, it's a myth that you need a lot of knowledge in this area. Security selection can be simplified to the point where you can make good selections effortlessly. Equally important, if you follow the five essentials, security selection won't be a make-or-break factor in your investing efforts. The purpose of this book is to make you a better investor, not to load you up with tips about specific investments. In the 1980s and 1990s, investors achieved success by mostly just being in the market. Over the next decade, I believe the key to success will be you. How you approach investing, how clear-headed is your understanding of the market's underlying realities, and whether your skills and attitudes are right for the times. Part 2, chapters 6 to 12, refines and provides specific ways to implement the five essentials. Included are my takes on surviving bear markets, the latest advance in index fund investing, and model portfolios that put into practice the essentials. In Chapter 10, I make the case for market timing. Part 3, chapters 13 to 19, discusses important and timeless lessons that I have learned over the years as an investor, investment advisor, money manager, editor, entrepreneur, and observer of human nature. These chapters show how you can profitably expand your general money knowledge. They will give you an overview of personal money management situations seldom, if ever, covered in other personal finance books or periodicals. Here are some of the topics covered. Acknowledging that investing is a science dealing with uncertainty, Chapter 13, titled For Clearer Thinking, shows that it's just as important to learn how to think as it is to learn what to think. It offers lessons in clear and critical thinking. Similarly, Chapter 14 discusses behavioral finance, now an important frontier in investing knowledge. With a few exceptions, my take on the subject ignores the academic approach, concentrating instead on practical applications. The purpose of these two chapters is to help you acquire the skepticism and creative thinking that are important to financial success. Again, the key will be you is not just an empty phrase. This adage is just as important as the fundamentals. Chapter 16 aims to help women achieve their investing goals, and in Chapter 17, I briefly discuss owning collectibles for profit. Another chapter tells you how to invest in a Broadway musical with a relatively small outlay. Few readers are likely to make such a high-risk investment, but my experience as a backer of Hairspray was fascinating and brought me so much enjoyment, I had to share it with you. Integrity is so important when you are giving your hard-earned dollars to impersonal businesses or total strangers that I have devoted an entire chapter to it. Because almost everybody makes far more money in the workplace than they make from investing, I offer advice in Chapter 19 to both employers and employees, based on my personal experiences as the owner of a small business and an employee of two large corporations. Although there is a chapter titled The No Work Way to a Comfortable Retirement, maybe, don't be misled. Investing without Wall Street is not a lazy man's guide or even a permanent portfolio strategy. Quite the contrary, it's for people who want maximum results for the time and effort they spend investing. It's for young investors who want to learn it right the first time. Investing without Wall Street also shares stories of interest. As Adam Smith said in the preface to The Money Game, the classic tale of Wall Street in the 1960s, enjoy the stories. They always teach more than the rules. That's what Wall Street does to sell stocks to investors. That's what I have done in Investing Without Wall Street. Recounted stories that will sell you investment strategies that are profitable for you, not for Wall Street's promoters. Although I favor funds, the insights I offer are relevant whether your preference is mutual funds, exchange-traded funds, or ETFs, stocks, or anything else. And for those of you who are wealthy enough to have personal money management, Investing Without Wall Street provides a valuable guide for riding herd on these advisors, something that every managed account client should do. Introduction. Take a journey with me. You might think that there is only one investing world, but there are many, and their differences go far beyond investing strategies or financial products. There are the separate realms for hedge fund operators, stockbrokers, commodity traders, gold bugs, and day traders. There are perma bulls and perma bears. There are also the worlds of investors who rely on advisors, the do-it-yourselfers, the stock pickers, asset allocators, market timers, trendsetters, and trend followers, the involved and the uninvolved. My foray into a different world explains these distinctions. Back in the 1990s, I was invited to make a speech to the subscribers of an internet stock market trading system. I knew that investors who traded on the internet were not the audience for my style of moderate risk, diversified investing. But the invitation had come through a friend who had recommended me, and the sponsor offered me a substantial fee, so I accepted. Before I was called to the podium, the president of the internet trading company jumped up and said he wanted to poll the audience, about 100 strong, to ascertain their risk preferences. Using a scale of 1 to 10, with 10 being the most aggressive investing and 1 being the most conservative, he asked, "How many people are 10s? About 5 people raised their hands. How many are 9s? About 25 people raised their hands. 8s? At least 50 responded. I thought to myself, good grief, I'm a 4, and this audience wants advice that will make them a killing in the market tomorrow. Well, I delivered my usual speech, and only one person walked out. Although I considered it a moral victory, I tried hard never to repeat that experience again. And thankfully, I never did. Time is precious, and I hate to waste investors' time with advice they are unlikely to accept. This audiobook is for investors with risk tolerances ranging from about 3 to 7. It's not for 8s, 9s, or 10s. If you're an 8 or higher and you're listening to a sample of this book online or through a library, don't listen any further. This book is not for you, and I don't want to waste your time. By my standards, you are not really an investor. You should be in a casino playing the slots. On the other hand, if you are a 1 or a 2, stick with your bank CDs, savings accounts, or e-bonds, unless you want to learn how to increase your wealth with only a moderate increase in risk. My world is primarily the world of diversified, low-cost, no-load mutual funds that you invest in for the long term. I first ventured into no-load funds because I figured that any financial product that is always on sale had to be the right world for me. A 4 is right for me, and some other number might be right for you. That's okay. People are different. In this audiobook, I would like to take you on a journey through my world of investing. It will be fun, and you'll find it worth your time. But before we get down to the main business of this audiobook, improving your investing skills, I want to briefly tell you about the town I grew up in, since it has a strong bearing on who I am and how I came by the advice I will be dispensing. How my journey began. I grew up in Deadwood, in the Black Hills of South Dakota. If you drove through Deadwood back in those days, you might have thought it was an ordinary small town. But Deadwood was unlike any other small town in the United States, and everyone living there knew it. Deadwood had been the scene of one of the country's most notable gold rushes, and the town never lost its frontier spirit. In the 40s, when I grew up there, the town had a population of 4,000. There are many small towns where people live because they can't make it in the big city, but that wasn't true of Deadwood. Some of the sharpest people I have ever met lived there. They could have made it anywhere, but they preferred Deadwood because of the breathtaking beauty of the Black Hills, its heritage, its sense of small-town intimacy, and its proximity to Mount Rushmore. There was great hunting, fishing, skiing, camping, and mountain climbing, all within an easy drive. For climbing, there was Devil's Tower, which later on gained fame in the Steven Spielberg movie Close Encounters of the Third Kind, and Harney Peak, which at 7,242 feet is the highest peak between the Rocky Mountains and the French Pyrenees. The town had a strong libertarian bent. Its main street, filled with prosperous stores, was the shopping center for 40 miles around. It was home to 7 churches and 7 bars, and each bar had a room in the back for gambling, usually slots, blackjack, and crap tables. There had always been gambling in Deadwood ever since the Gold Rush days. Technically, it wasn't legal, but the state never bothered to enforce the law. In those days, the 1930s and 1940s, Deadwood also had 3 houses of prostitution. All were on Main Street on second floors above the bars. And they all had neon signs at street level advertising their presence. The signs read, Ma's Nifty, The Cozy, and the Shasta. Everybody in town favored these businesses, including the clergy, because they brought in tourists, which were one of the 2 lifeblood industries of the town. Everybody certainly included my dad, who was born and raised in Deadwood and was totally accustomed to this environment. He approved of anything that brought in business. The girls, as everybody called them, did a lot of shopping in my dad's ladies' ready-to-wear store. The other lifeblood was gold mining. The fabled Homestake Mine, once owned by George Hearst, William Randolph Hearst's father, at the time the largest gold mine in the Americas, was located in Deadwood and in nearby Leeds, South Dakota. The mine was listed on the New York Stock Exchange, or NYSE, in 1879 and continued producing gold for more than 120 years. Homestake became the longest listed stock in the history of the NYSE, and brought millions of dollars of revenue into town. Deadwood's liquor laws were loose, to put it mildly. Of course, South Dakota had laws regulating drinking, and I guess they applied to Deadwood too. But the reality was that liquor was regulated in Deadwood not so much by age as by height. If you were tall enough to stand at the bar and pound it with your fist, it was likely you would be served. You could even drink 3.2 beer legally at age 15. Another convenient thing about Deadwood, and actually the entire state of South Dakota, was that you didn't need a driver's license to drive a car in those days. The sole requirement was to be 15 years old. Consequently, when we all got to be about 14 and a half, we badgered our fathers to teach us how to drive so we could drive on our own as soon as we reached 15. During my lifetime, things changed radically in Deadwood. In 1947, the state of South Dakota finally decided to enforce the gambling laws, and that had a crippling impact on commerce. The brothels were closed in the late 1970s in an action that drew national coverage. Then one day, right after the last brothel closed, hundreds of people paraded down Main Street holding up banners reading, "Bring back our girls." In 1989, Deadwood got a new lease on life when the state of South Dakota made the town an exception to its gambling laws, just as New Jersey did for Atlantic City. Main Street, which used to have regular stores catering to families, is now wall-to-wall gambling casinos its entire length, 139 in all if you count the stores with slots. The ladies' ready-to-wear store, once owned by my dad, is now a casino called the Midnight Star, owned by the actor Kevin Costner and his brother. The new gambling money has spruced up the town. The streets have been repaved, and almost all of the storefronts are new. There are several new hotels and restaurants. And it was just in time. 2 years later, the Homestake Mine, its gold finally exhausted, closed for good. If it hadn't been for the gambling dispensation granted by the state, Deadwood would have become a ghost town. Even with the gambling, the town's population has dwindled to 1,270, according to U.S. 2010 census. Deadwood will be around for a long time, but it's not the same town now that it was for my generation. In 1964, Deadwood became the only city in the United States to be named a National Historic Landmark. In 2004, it received a new measure of fame when HBO launched a Western TV series, Deadwood, set there. In 2009, ForbesTraveler.com selected Deadwood as one of the 20 prettiest towns in America. And now you need a license to drive in the state of South Dakota, including Deadwood. When gambling closed in Deadwood, many of the town's gamblers moved to Las Vegas. So the first time I went to Las Vegas, I looked up two of them, Virgil Rakestraw, or Rakey, and Eli Gasson. I found Rakey, a big hulk of a man, dealing at a roulette wheel at the Stardust Casino. When he took a coffee break, we discussed gambling. "Never gamble in Vegas," he admonished. "It's different than Deadwood." I knew what he meant. In Deadwood, if the casino saw a local man gambling away the rent and food money, they made him stop for the sake of his and his family's well-being. That didn't happen in impersonal Las Vegas. I found Eli working as a pit boss at a small casino. Over coffee, he also warned me not to gamble in Vegas, though he made an exception for poker. I politely accepted his advice, but it was meaningless to me. I knew Eli was a world-class poker player. According to legend, probably Eli's, he was the champion poker player of the Pacific Fleet during World War II. How he came by this title I never understood, although I believe there was some legitimacy to the claim. If he were around today, I'm pretty sure he would be earning big bucks on TV. Poker is a game of immense skill, not luck, although in the short run, luck can temporarily overcome skill, just as it can in economic life. I am sorely lacking in the skills needed to win at poker. I know because I learned how to play the game at Boy Scout camp and never won. In addition, poker too is a zero-sum game. And finally, in poker, if you lose, there is no tarp to bail you out. When I asked my 8-year-old granddaughter, Sarah Jacobs, if she knew what a casino was, she said, "Sure, it's a place where you play with real money." For many years, I went to Vegas once a year to speak at the Money Show. I always heeded Rakey's and Eli's advice, although the real reason I don't gamble is that gambling is a zero-sum game less the house edge, meaning for every winner, there's a loser. Stocks, on the other hand, are a positive-sum game. By that I mean it's quite possible and often likely for all the players to win, since they can participate in earnings growth over time. I don't like to lose, so I prefer the far better odds of long-term investing. I have often thought that the world of gambling I had grown up with led me to the world of investing. I bought my first stock, Homestake Mining, when I was still in high school. The money came mostly from summer jobs. I held it for 3 years and sold it for a small loss. In retrospect, my mistake was confusing familiarity with knowledge. Just because I could see the mine from my house, it didn't mean I had sufficient knowledge of the politics and economics of the mining industry. I didn't even know Homestake's earnings. And even if I had known Homestake's earnings, I would not have known how to interpret them. I left Deadwood to attend college, and I never did go back to live there. Had I would have become the third generation of my family to operate the family stores. During the Korean War, the Army called me up and, in its infinite wisdom, stationed me in Times Square. New York hooked me. I liked the theater, museums, and most of all its restaurants, which were far better than Deadwood's. Upon discharge, I decided to stay in New York. Much as I liked Deadwood, New York was my kind of town. But even with my parents now gone, I still returned to Deadwood for short visits every few years or so. Chance made me a New Yorker, but I probably always was. New York, New York. I have had two careers in New York. The first career was in broadcasting. I worked 25 years for ABC TV and NBC TV doing media research. I became an expert in TV ratings. I studied and forecast audiences, which ironically was good training for forecasting mutual fund performance. This is not the book for broadcasting stories, but there was one time when I was able to combine my broadcasting industry knowledge with my interest in investing. In late 1965, ABC invited hundreds of advertising executives to breakfast to preview programming that would premiere in a few weeks. On this morning, a 5-minute clip of the show that would become Batman was screened. It seemed to me, and others, that this show was certain to be a smash hit. Back in the department, we researchers discussed how to capitalize on this early information. Buy ABC? No, we reasoned. A single program, even a major hit, wouldn't move ABC stock. The production company, 20th Century Fox? No, for pretty much the same reason. What about the company that held the merchandising rights to Batman characters? We checked and found these rights were held by National Periodical, the same company that published Batman comic books. We felt the success of the TV show could have a significant impact on National Periodical's earnings. Less than an hour had elapsed since we had previewed the film. Several of us bought National Periodical stock at what turned out to be a bottom. Then we did a very smart thing. Down the hall from the research department was the ABC publicity department, with about a dozen of the best publicity agents you ever saw in your life. We sauntered down there and casually mentioned the fruits of our thinking. They bought the stock too. Then the most amazing thing happened. Within a week, stories about National Periodical began appearing across the country, in newspapers, magazines, on TV, everywhere. It was incredible. The stock jumped 50% in a few weeks and eventually doubled in the midst of the 1966 bear market. It wasn't the most money I ever made, but it was surely the most satisfying. We had received good information, and we analyzed it correctly. Not bad for a bunch of amateurs. In January 1979, I launched the No Load Fund Investor in what newsletter people call a kitchen table operation. That is to say, I wrote the newsletter during evenings and weekends while still keeping my day job at NBC. My timing was good. Investors were just getting over the severe bear market of the early 1970s. I published the newsletter quarterly for more than 3 years and watched it grow into a real business. Then, in August 1982, a new bull market began with a vengeance. I knew my day had come. When the bull was a week old, I quit my day job at NBC. I was 51 at the time. Most of my colleagues thought I had been fired. They couldn't imagine anybody quitting a good job. I was a director, so close to early retirement age. But for me, it was the moment to go full-time on a lucrative second career as a newsletter editor and publisher. About 15 years later, the Sunday morning TV show, The Wall Street Journal Report, profiled three people who had created notable second careers. The three were Ray Kroc, the founder of the modern McDonald's, Colonel Harlan Sanders of Kentucky Fried Chicken fame, and me, Sheldon Jacobs, editor of the No Load Fund Investor. Part 1. The Five Essentials. Chapter 1. The First Essential. Determine the right asset allocation. Now let's turn to improving your investing skills. Chapters 1 and 2 are the most important in this book. To give you an idea of how important they are, Over 2,500 books and countless magazine and newspaper articles have been written on the subject of how to spread your money among and within classes of assets. Given its fundamental nature, you would think that virtually every investor would be well acquainted with the principles of diversification. Yet I find that such is not the case. I continually run across investors who have only the haziest idea of how to correctly implement an asset allocation and diversification strategy. I use a quick test to gauge their competency in this area. Question: do you know what percentage of your portfolio is currently invested in equities? Yes, no, without looking it up? If you don't carry that number in your head, you may not be applying whatever you do know correctly. There is a tendency to ignore diversification, perhaps because it is so basic, and a fair number invest with the belief that they already know it all. But that's not usually the case. So let's start at the beginning. The basics. Asset allocation basically means holding various asset classes whose performance is uncorrelated. That is, they fluctuate independently of each other. That's the whole point. If two investments fluctuate in tandem, they won't provide diversification or reduce risk. The three most important asset classes for individuals are stocks, bonds, and cash. At the institutional level, there are many more. For convenience's sake, I'm going to call these classes of assets baskets. There is virtually no correlation among the three basic baskets. Zero is no correlation. 1.00 and negative 1.00 are perfect positive and negative correlations. This is critical. You want zero correlation, or better yet, negative correlation. If two asset classes have a high positive correlation, then they are really variations of the same asset class and don't increase diversification. Now you see why spreading your money among stocks, bonds, and cash gives you superior diversification and risk control. You are always at risk no matter what you do, but with this approach, you have dramatically reduced the likelihood that all your investments decline at once. How you allocate these baskets in your portfolio can determine up to 90% of your returns. This alone tells you where you should be spending your investing time. If you own your own business, though, diversification may not be an option. You will probably have all your money in it. But that's not the case when you invest in other people's businesses. That's what you do when you buy listed stocks. There you may have the choice of diversification or concentrated investing. Some people follow the concentrated path in investing, and some of those people become very, very wealthy. But in all likelihood, you will never know enough about the workings of publicly traded companies or how the actions of other investors will impact your holdings to be comfortable putting all your money in one or even a few stocks. This also applies to investing in companies you work for, if they are large enough to have publicly traded stock. Let me be very specific. Diversification is not about maximizing profits. It's about reducing risk. And there is no better way to reduce risk. It's not just for individuals either. Many hedge fund and mutual fund pros have dispensed with diversification and come to grief because it is impossible to be expert in every holding. Expert or layman, when bad things happen, there is really no protection other than diversification. I think one of the reasons the Investor newsletter led the nation in risk-adjusted returns for so many years, we were number one among all newsletters for the 20 years ending June 2008, is because we had the best asset allocation. We were one of the few newsletters that routinely allocated part of our model portfolios to bonds. Most newsletter portfolios recommend stocks only, or even higher risk securities such as options. Learn from the big boys. Even though you may never be an institutional player, it's useful to know what the big boys do. Here's a comprehensive allocation developed by David Swinson, who manages Yale's multi-billion dollar endowment. He suggests six baskets with no asset class greater than 30% or less than 5%. 1. Domestic stocks, 30%. 2. Foreign stocks, 15%. 3. emerging market stocks, 5%. 4. Real estate, 20%. 5. Treasury bonds, 15%. 6. Treasury inflation protected securities, or TIPS, 15%. For individuals with substantial assets, this allocation makes a great deal of sense. Another asset class to consider is commodities, which are much simpler to invest in nowadays with the advent of sector exchange traded funds, or ETFs. How the ancients allocated their wealth. Many contemporary investing strategies, such as random walk, modern portfolio theory, index funds, and even growth stock investing, were developed after World War II and are relatively new. But asset allocation is not new. It's been around as long as people have had wealth. The oldest recorded asset allocation advice may be from biblical times. The Talmud, a record of rabbinic discussions pertaining to Jewish law, ethics, customs, and history, circa 1200 BC to AD 500, recommends, "Let every man divide his money into three parts, and invest a third in land, a third in business, and let him keep a third in reserve." Today, we would call these three baskets real estate, common stocks, and money funds. You can clearly prosper with that advice right now. Jumping to more recent history, the fabled Rothschild family had an asset allocation formula that worked well for over a century and, amazingly, remains totally relevant today. The Rothschilds placed one-third of their wealth in each of three baskets: securities, real estate, and art. It's interesting that both historic examples allocated wealth into three baskets, and that's basically what most individuals do today, except that our baskets are slightly different. Today we categorize the baskets as stocks, bonds, and cash, but the principle of three endures as a sound minimum. And here's another historic example of diversification. In Shakespeare's Merchant of Venice, Antonio declares, "My ventures are not in one bottom trusted." And of course, that's what insurance is all about, spreading the risk through diversification. Lloyd's of London was founded around 1688 to insure shipping, so a shipper could put all his cargo in one bottom. It's not known when American investors began to allocate their assets to both stocks and bonds, but the first balanced fund, Vanguard Wellington, was launched in 1929. Vanguard Wellington utilized a 60-40 distribution, stocks to bonds, which is still basic today. Of course, we are more sophisticated now, and at the institutional level, some large portfolios have as many as 11 baskets. That's too much for most individuals, but you can certainly consider commodities, timber, foreign bonds, inflation-protected bonds, gold, real estate, art, collectibles such as fine wines, rare books, classic cars, jewelry, and memorabilia. Still, the big three are all you absolutely need. Your most important task: determining the best asset allocation for you. First of all, there is no single right allocation. It's essential to choose an allocation that works for you, considers your current holdings, and most importantly, takes into account a long-term market forecast and your personal risk profile, which depends on your financial ability to tolerate risk and your willingness to do so. Regardless of what you choose, the important thing is to know your target asset allocation and either stick reasonably close to it or have logical reasons for not doing so. Here are some of the factors you need to consider to reach your own personal allocation. 1. How many years before you need the money, either for retirement or for other purposes such as college? 2. How long does the money have to last in retirement? An estimate is helpful. 3. How easily can market losses be replaced? 4. How much inflation protection do you need? 5. Age. Generally, older people should take less risk, but there are some significant exceptions. For most people, age is closely linked to the time horizon. These factors are really all facets of what is called your time horizon. For most people, that's the bottom line. In addition, consider 1. Wealth, more important than most realize. It's dangerous to take substantial equity risks if you don't have a cushion. 2. Family. How solid is your marriage? What child-rearing expenses are you likely to incur, including college costs and possible wedding expenses? 3. Are there any circumstances under which you would wind up being financially responsible for any other members of your family? Have you ever co-signed a loan? 4. Income, if you are still working, or cash flow, if you are not. How great is it? How stable is it? The more you have, the easier it is to accept risk. 5. How much to set aside for emergencies? 6. How much money do you want to set aside for charities? 7. Equity market outlook. Are you long-term bullish or bearish? 8. Are your stocks or equity funds more or less risky than the market? 9. How much are you willing to lose without cutting your losses? 10. How much volatility can you accept? 11. What is your current allocation and how happy are you with it? 12. How closely are your earnings linked to the stock market? If you are an investment professional or work for an investment professional, putting your personal wealth in the market can leave you dangerously undiversified. Putting all these factors together for optimum results is no small job. I suggest some specific model portfolios later on. However, here's a shortcut for people who want to do it themselves. Go to the Vanguard Personal Investors website and using the "What are you looking for?" search box, type in "Investor Questionnaire." Answer the questions and submit. The program will suggest an allocation that might work for you. I keep my personal asset allocation on a spreadsheet and recommend you do so too. It can be updated anytime by just punching in a few closing prices, which you can get online. It doesn't take any time at all. I do mine in less than 5 minutes. If you are not computer literate, use a calculator. Check your allocations regularly. This discipline is far more important than keeping track of your favorite stock or fund. Also, by including cash in a spreadsheet, you are able to take personal spending into account. I suggest benchmarking total financial assets to the previous December 31st, so you know at all times if you are spending more than you are making and appreciating. For an in-depth, professional look at asset allocation, read the second edition of The Art of Asset Allocation by David M. Darst, McGraw-Hill, 2008. Darst is a managing director at Morgan Stanley. Another good book on the subject is All About Asset Allocation by Richard A. Ferry, CFA, McGraw-Hill, 2006. Important lessons in this chapter. 1. There is nothing more important than asset allocation. Do it first and check it the most often. Change it when necessary. Your asset allocation should be foremost in your mind at all times. 2. Above all, when you get your asset allocation right, you'll be around to invest another day. Chapters 3 and 7 will have specific advice. Chapter 2. The second essential. Diversify within asset classes. After you've established your asset allocation, the next step is to diversify within each asset class, sometimes called sub-asset allocation or second-tier diversification. In the equity allocation, for example, it means diversifying among large and small-cap stocks, U.S. and international, and so on. These definitions are not hard and fast. Many people, for example, would consider international stocks a separate asset class. Sub-asset equity allocations have totally different characteristics than asset allocations. In this case, there is a substantial long-run correlation between most sub-asset class correlations. One institutional study found that when correlating 5 sub-asset equity classes, the lowest correlation of U.S. core stocks to emerging market stocks was a very substantial 0.82. Most correlations ran in the high 0.90s. What these facts mean is that determining sub-asset allocations is far less important than determining asset allocations and probably even less important than selecting individual funds. This is the part of investing where you can take shortcuts and do it the easy way. Diversify stocks with broad-based index funds. The best way to begin the sub-asset allocation process is to pick a broad-based index fund for your core holding. Index funds, compared to the alternatives, are no-brainers. Here are some of their advantages. 1. Index funds are easy to select. 2. Index funds have lower costs because their portfolios are traded infrequently and they don't incur management and research costs. 3. Index funds, which track a known index, are not dependent on managerial expertise the way actively managed funds are. It doesn't matter if an index fund manager leaves his fund. It may matter greatly if the manager of an actively managed fund quits. That means index funds have a more consistent performance. 4. You don't get fooled into buying because of great performance and then find out the active manager just had a hot streak. 5. Index funds have less of a problem with assets growing to an unwieldy size. Still, in this business, all the good reasons in the world don't mean a thing if the investment doesn't perform. Great risk-adjusted returns are pretty much everything. Forget the concept. Forget the academic theory. The proof is in the performance. The fact is that over any decent period, indexing outperforms the average mutual fund. One major disadvantage of index funds has become less significant over time. Index funds are always fully invested, so they have no bear market protection. It used to be that a sizable number of actively managed funds would go to cash in bear markets, so their bear market performance could be considerably better than that of index funds. This isn't true anymore. After the secular bull market of the 1980s and 1990s, most actively managed funds found that they had to stay reasonably fully invested at all times to be competitive. At year-end 2008, a very bearish moment, the average stock fund had only 5.2% of its assets in cash, and a good part of that was necessary to meet redemptions, not because of an investment strategy. Let me conclude with the story that brought home the advantages of index fund investing to me. In the late 1980s, I received a call from Jonathan Clements, then a columnist with the Wall Street Journal. "Sheldon," he said, "if you could only recommend one fund, which one would it be?" I tossed out a name and forgot about it. 5 years later, Jonathan called me again and said, "Congratulations, Sheldon, you're in second place." "Second place in what?" I asked. "The contest," he replied. "Don't you remember I asked you to pick one fund?" I should have asked, "What contest?" But instead I asked, "What fund did I pick?" "The Vanguard Total Stock Market Index Fund." I breathed a sigh of relief. Sequel. In late December 2009, the results of a different year-end contest in the Chicago Tribune and syndicated elsewhere were announced. I came in second out of 8 contestants. My picks? 2 index funds, PowerShares FTSE RAFI US 1000 Exchange Traded Fund, ticker PRF, and Vanguard Total Stock Market Fund, ticker VTSMX. I beat 6 pros with index funds. Only one beat me. The most surefire way of participating in any up market is the Vanguard Total Stock Market Fund, or ticker VTI, the ETF version. I am frequently asked to recommend a fund for a child. I always suggest a total stock market fund. It's the best single investment you can find for the kid. In this book, I primarily recommend broad-based index funds. I do not recommend index funds that focus on narrow sectors such as tech or actively managed portfolios. Those recommendations belong in periodical literature that can be updated frequently. There are few exceptions, primarily specialty funds that complete recommended themes. In all cases, if any of these recommendations or mentions interests you, check them out carefully before buying. Defining broad-based. My definition of a broad-based index fund is one that invests in the total stock market by holding 1,000 or more stocks. These broad-based index funds are available from several no-load fund groups with very low continuing management fees. For all practical purposes, total stock market funds own all listed stocks, even though they may just sample the smallest ones. Check Vanguard, Fidelity, Charles Schwab, and T. Rowe Price for these funds. Some of these funds go by names other than total stock market, so you may need to talk to a phone rep at these groups for details. There are other exchange-traded funds that also offer wide diversification. Three in this category are the iShares DJ U.S. Total Market Index, ticker IYY, the iShares Russell 3000, ticker IWV, and PowerShares FTSE RAFI U.S. 1000 exchange-traded fund, ticker PRF, which is discussed in Chapter 8. My definition of broad-based deliberately excludes S&P 500 funds. That's because the S&P 500 is a large cap index that omits dynamic small companies that are often market leaders. Moreover, the index has greater turnover than I would prefer, about 20 stocks a year on average. Some professionals argue that the 500 is actively managed by Standard & Poor's. There is truth to this assertion. It's an interesting quirk that the new stocks that S&P has added over the years have done worse than the stocks they replaced. For whatever it's worth, 55% of my own equity portfolio is invested in broad-based index funds, plus another 24% is invested in low-cost, narrow-based index funds. Sometimes diversification can be employed in odd situations. The smartest diversification ever. As a 26-year-old investor in 1939, at the outset of World War II, the late Sir John Templeton borrowed $10,000 and bought 100 shares of every stock trading at $1 a share or less on the New York and American stock exchanges. He wound up with a total of 104 companies, 34 of which were in bankruptcy at the time he bought them. 4 years later, he sold these stocks for more than $40,000. That's $500,000 in today's money. Only four turned out to be worthless. Templeton went on to found the Templeton Funds, now Franklin Templeton, and became one of the best and most respected fund managers ever. Forget style diversification. Diversifying by style has become a big deal. Many advisors and many investment publications will go into great detail explaining style diversification. They will admonish you to diversify between growth and value stocks, and between large, mid, and small capitalization stocks. They will try to make this all seem very necessary by explaining the system popularized by Morningstar in 1992. Morningstar categorizes stocks or funds into 9 different style boxes. Their matrix, which looks like a tic-tac-toe board, has 3 cap sizes on the vertical axis and growth, blend, and value on the horizontal axis. Blend means the security has both growth and value stocks. In my opinion, diversification by style has been tremendously overemphasized. I think the biggest benefit to this strategy is that it gives investment advisors the opportunity to justify their fees by forecasting which styles will be the best performers and making recommendations in each style box. The fund groups benefit by having more products to sell. This, by the way, is a relatively new development. Years ago, funds had ordinary names like the Dreyfus Fund, Babson Fund, Magellan, or the Manhattan Fund. Only 2 funds had growth in their names in 1949. Today, there are many, many funds devoted to specific style, such as Fidelity Small Cap Growth Fund or T. Rowe Price Mid Cap Value Index Fund. There are a number of reasons why fund sponsors find differentiating their funds this way to be advantageous, none of them having much to do with you. 1. With more than 5,000 equity funds extant, they need to distinguish their products for marketing reasons. Style designations in their names are one way to accomplish this. 2. If a large group has narrowly focused funds in every style category, it will almost always have some winners that can be promoted. And as for the laggards, poor performance can be excused by noting that the style is out of favor. 3. Since advisors will put their clients' money in several of these funds to achieve style diversification, the group has a greater chance of gathering assets. It's hard to forecast styles. It is extremely difficult at best to forecast the future, and that certainly includes trying to forecast which styles will be the best performers. Performance leadership in these style-based asset classes may run in cycles, but these cycles are far from regular and difficult to predict. Furthermore, styles don't really qualify as asset classes. Stocks and bonds are clearly different asset classes. They often fail to move in sync with each other. But the differences between styles are usually a matter of degree. If large caps are going to gain, chances are so will mid and small caps, just to different degrees and at different times in the economic cycle. The same is true on the downside. That's a shame. In both cases, we would vastly prefer the reverse. No correlation in bear markets to minimize our losses, and high correlation in bull markets when
we want. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.